Hi everyone, welcome to the first video for our course. Before I get started, I wanted to go over a few things and tell you a little bit how I think these videos should be used. First of all, these lectures are meant to serve mainly as a study guide, so they're not fully fledged lecture videos containing all the material, in particular all the proofs. They are more kind of study guides in the sense that they provide, establish a narrative, they connect the material, they point out important issues, provide some background at times. And I recommend to using them as follows. You just start the video, but whenever you reach a result, you just push pause and try to prove the statement yourself first. I think that's quite important because if you just take a few minutes before you read the proof and take a few minutes to think about the result yourself and how you would attack it, what a possible strategy would be, I think it also helps you learn the theorem or the result better. Once you continue the video, you will see a basic outline of the proof, or at least a hint, so you can then see if this coincides with what you had in mind. That tells you, yeah, I'm on the right path here, and then you can work out the details as desired. Of course, you should always try to work out details as much as you can, and then a reference to a full proof finally will appear as a pop-up. So in this lecture we'll talk about cardinals and alephs. Remember our goal from the beginning of the class was to find a canonical representative for cardinality equivalence classes. Now we know that ordinals are actually canonical representatives for well orders. And we've also seen that if we assume that the axiom of choice holds, which in turn is equivalent to the well ordering principle, we see that every set can be well ordered. Meaning now that we can assign every set a well ordering, that well ordering then by the isomorphism theorem for well orderings is isomorphic to some ordinal. So we can expect to pick out our canonical representative among the ordinals. The problem, however, is that not every ordinal, right, can be a representative of cardinality. So for example, if we look at just the two ordinals omega and omega plus 1, they are equinumerous, so there's a bijection between the two, because we can just map the plus 1, so omega, we map it to 0, so we put it at the beginning of omega here, right, and then map the rest of this omega here to omega over here. Which can be clearly be done in a bijective way, right? So they both have the same cardinality, but they are different ordinals. So how do we pick our representative among the ordinals of the same cardinality? Well, the ordinals are well ordered, right? So we can actually just pick the least representative. So to sum up this and give a formal definition of cardinals, an ordinal beta is a cardinal if it is not equinumerous with a smaller ordinal. So that means for all ordinals less than beta, alpha is not, there's no bijection between alpha and beta. Notation-wise, we're going to use kappa, lambda, mu, and so on for cardinals. Let's go over a few examples. Any finite ordinal is a cardinal. Omega is a cardinal. It's the smallest infinite cardinal. And when we refer to as omega, to omega as a cardinal, we're going to use this notation here. It's the Aleph zero, right? It's the Hebrew letter Aleph, and usually then subscripted with a zero, so it's Aleph zero or Aleph naught. Finally, we observe that alpha is an infinite ordinal, then alpha plus 1 is not a cardinal. And the reason for that is similar to what we saw before, namely when we observe that omega is actually can be mapped bijectively to omega plus 1. Similarly, if alpha is an infinite ordinal, it can always be mapped bijectively to alpha plus 1. So alpha plus 1 cannot be a cardinal because there is an equinumerous ordinal smaller than it. Now, as we observed before, we can now show, assuming that the axiom of choice holds, that every set X is equinumerous to a unique cardinal denoted by card X or just absolute value X here. The reason for that, again, is that every set can be well ordered, assuming the axiom of choice. That set, or that well ordering, is isomorphic to a unique ordinal, right? And then we can pass to the least equinumerous ordinal to that, and that's the cardinality of X. Okay. In order to study the cardinality relation and the cardinality ordering, we already started that. We had a few results, like the Cantor-Schroeder-Bernstein theorem, right? But let's add one more tool to our toolbox, which is given by the following proposition. So if X and Y are sets, and in particular X is not the empty set, then the following are equivalent. Cardinality of X is less than the cardinality of less than or equal to the cardinality of Y. There exists an injection from X into Y, right? Or equivalent to that, and that's the new point really for us, is that there exists a surjection G from Y into X. Think a little bit how you would prove the direction 3-2. The idea is, here as a hint, pass to a corresponding surjection between cardinals, right? Because both have cardinals associated with them, and this makes it possible to pick the least one in a pre-image. So we know now that the cardinals sit inside the ordinals. There are every cardinal is an ordinal, but not every ordinal is a cardinal. So the question would be now, can we somehow enumerate the cardinals inside the ordinals in a nice way? And one way to do this would be to try to generate them inductively, similar to how we enumerated the ordinals by means of a transfinite process. So we would start, let's start with the infinite cardinals right away, because in the finite case everything is settled. So let's start with the least infinite ordinal omega. We call that Aleph zero. Now, by Cantor's theorem, for every cardinal kappa, there exists a strictly larger one. So we know that kappa is strictly less than the cardinality of the power set of kappa. Right? Now, among the strictly larger ones, there must be a smallest one, right? Because cardinals are ordinals. And let's denote this cardinal by kappa plus, the cardinal successor. So This is the cardinal successor, kappa plus. Before, we denoted also the ordinal successor by this superscript plus, but those two operations are not the same. If I go ordinal successor from omega, I get to omega plus 1, right, which is not a cardinal. So we use from now on alpha plus 1 for ordinal successor to avoid this confusion. Right? So kappa plus, so the superscript clause from now on, will always denote the cardinal successor. Mimicking this process that we did transfinitely enumerate the ordinals, we can now get a hierarchy for cardinals, which is called the Aleph hierarchy. So Aleph 0 is omega, Aleph sub alpha plus 1, so this here is always an ordinal, right? So this is an ordinal. And so that would just be the cardinal successor to Aleph sub alpha. And then, so this would take care of the successor stages. And then we have to take care of the limit stages. And there we would say for gamma limit, we would put Aleph sub gamma to be the supremum of the Aleph sub beta, where beta is less than gamma. Of course, to make this work, or so that this actually defines a cardinal, we need to make sure that this supremum here is actually a cardinal. And what you can prove that this is indeed the case, indeed something more general holds, if X is a set of cardinals, then lambda, the supremum over all cardinals in that set X, is again a cardinal. So while the previous proposition made sure that every element in that Aleph hierarchy is actually a cardinal, it's not clear from the beginning that we actually catch every cardinal this way. And that's the subject of this proposition here. Every infinite cardinal kappa is of the form kappa equals Aleph sub alpha for some ordinal alpha. Now, before I give you a basic outline of the proof, again, I encourage you to take a few minutes and think about how to prove this yourself. And here's a basic outline of the proof. So first, you would observe that this mapping, if you map an ordinal beta to Aleph beta, that's a strictly increasing map. So this map here is strictly increasing. It's a map from ordinals to ordinals. So we've seen before that this implies that beta is actually less than or equal to the image of the map of beta under this mapping. So in this case, it would be Aleph sub beta. And therefore, it easily follows that kappa is less than Aleph sub kappa plus 1. So we definitely know that there is an element of the Aleph hierarchy that's greater than our given infinite cardinal kappa. Now what we do is we pick alpha minimal such that Aleph sub alpha is greater than kappa. Now, if alpha were a limit, then it is not hard to see that then kappa must actually already be part of an element of an earlier Aleph beta, contradicting the minimality of alpha. So it therefore follows that alpha must be a successor ordinal, let's say beta plus 1, and kappa must be greater than equal to beta and strictly less than Aleph sub beta plus 1, which is equal to Aleph sub alpha, right? But by the definition of the Alephs, Aleph beta plus 1 is the smallest cardinal greater than Aleph beta, right? So there cannot be another cardinal truly in between Aleph beta and Aleph beta plus 1. Hence, kappa is equal to Aleph beta.